changes.
January 25th school committee meeting to order. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Start the meeting with public input with anything that's not on the agenda this evening. Yes?
Only on things not on the agenda?
If you have something regarding the budget, you can speak at that point in time. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The entire school committee, I believe, received this email from Michelle Samphy, a parent in the community about a week ago?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. She has asked that I read it as part of public input, so I'm going to read this email from Ms. Samphy. She has students at Barrows and Wood End. It's regarding, last year, we were able in our budget to support the position of a board-certified behavior analyst, and her family has been impacted by this decision. So she writes, "I was touched during the January 14th, 2016 school committee meeting when a member of the CPAC read a testimonial about how a Reading family and their child's lives have improved as a result of the support of the in-district BCBA and support of other members of the child's team. Our family has also benefited by the support and expertise of the district's BCBA, and I would like to briefly share how. Our daughter Megan has the ability to outsmart people, particularly adults, because she has Down syndrome, and people often underestimate her because of her disability. Megan is an energetic, push it to the limit, spunky, and very compassionate 8-year-old. She has experienced challenges in the area of behavior since her early days at the Rise Preschool. We have attended numerous meetings and have committed ourselves to further educating ourselves to best support Megan. The in-district BCBA got Megan's number upon her first encounter with Megan. The monthly home visits are wonderful brainstorming and information sharing meetings. Lisa Studer has trained and consulted with Megan's team members weekly. It has been a true team effort and strengthened the bond between home and school. We attend less meetings, are always adding strategies to our toolbox, and the stress of meeting Megan's needs has lessened. Thank you for adding this position. In better budget years, I believe more BCBAs in district would benefit all children, teachers, paraprofessionals, and families. We are very grateful."
Thank you,
Mr. Chair.
Any other comments? Thank you. We have the consent agenda. Is there anyone that would like anything removed from the consent? Yes, Ms. Perrell.
Mr. Chair, I would like to remove the donation from Samantha's Harvest from the consent agenda.
Okay, thank you.
Second.
All those in favor? 5-0. Okay, let's, do we have another motion?
Yes, move to approve the remaining consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Now to the, Lisa, Rob, Sam, would you like to come up?
Just bring a chair.
Yes, you can sit right here.
Myself comfortable.
Hi, Sam.
Hi. So, thank you so much for allowing us to come this evening to come and present our annual donation to the school committee and the school district. Last year was my first year being on the side of the table and being able to make the presentation. In previous years, we've had other board members come to present, like Mrs. Sanfi, who is a budget parent. And as you just heard from her letter that she so articulately sent, we're very lucky to have her on our board. She's a wonderful advocate and helps us in many ways to realize our mission, which is to educate everybody and support organizations and people who have Down syndrome. And what we do is we have numerous fundraisers, awareness raisers throughout the year, and what we do is we take the money that we really, really work hard to raise every year and donate it to various organizations, the Reading Public Schools being one of them now for the 14th year. So, as always with our donation, there are no strings attached. But as I think from the beginning, and now Mrs. Wilson has carried on the tradition of using the donation that we make for professional development for special and general educators. So we are very happy tonight to be able to present you with a $3,000 check from Samantha's Harvest. And would you like to give that to Dr. Doherty?
Yes, I would.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So if I could just, Mr. Chair, if I could just make a shameless plug for our next event. it is on Saturday, March 5th, from 2 to 5 at Bunratty Tavern in Reading. We're going to have a wine and beer tasting. So.
Thank you. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair,
we'll do this motion.
Oh, okay. Move to approve, very gratefully approve, the donation from Samantha's Harvest in the amount of $3,000.
Second. Any discussion?
Yes. No, I just wanted to say that it's just a pleasure. Of the 13 years, I think Samantha's Harvest has been coming to this committee just about every year. And it's wonderful to see how Sam has just grown and become such a fine young woman.
Thank you very much.
Well,
it takes a village, and we appreciate all the support that we get from the school district and everyone in our community who knows Sam, and I think just about everyone does. So we appreciate that support from everyone, as Mrs. Sanfi articulated in her letter, too. Thank you.
Thanks. All those in favor? 5-0.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Can I just acknowledge something on the other consent item?
I
just want to acknowledge the other donation that we approved on a consent agenda was from the Friends of Reading Wrestling, and it's a sizable donation of $13,000, and it's going to enable the wrestling, our wrestling team, to have enough mats to run the MIAA All-States. And, you know, that's a huge honor. It's really fabulous to be able to have that kind of equipment to support the team, and for us to be able to host those events, you know, similar to you know, the robotics event that was hosted. Sometimes there's additional equipment that's needed to be able to run the meet fast enough to be a host site. So really, I just wanted to acknowledge that, because it's really enables the district to really add another feature to the program.
Thank you. Great. Are there any reports?
Not much to change since last Thursday.
Just an impossible party.
I just wanted to mention again that this Saturday evening, the Reading High School girls varsity hockey team is sponsoring Pink the Rink. They're playing Lexington. The game's at 7:45, but the proceeds benefit breast cancer awareness, and they do all types of raffles. They have tickets and baskets, and it's a nice thing, so come out and support the girls.
Elaine?
Nope, I'm all set.
Anything over here?
No.
Mm-hmm. Great. Yes?
We do have a CPAC meeting this Thursday night.
Didn't want to make it too public unless things changed here. But that's okay.
Sorry.
That's okay.
So.
Planning for Thursday, it's up.
At this point in the evening, we'll start our budget discussion. I did want to, before Dr. Dory presents, just remind the committee that the budget that we've been presented by the superintendent is $150,000 higher than the guidance that was given by the FinCom. And, you know, that in all likelihood, I'm not 100% sure, but in all likelihood, the budget that will be presented by the town manager to the FinCom will be out of line by $150,000. History has been that he has, or that whoever the town manager, they will put forward what they view as a balanced budget. And we've been down that road before. And, you know, I support this budget, and we'll be prepared to present, you know, what the superintendent has requested. But we should all be mindful of that and be prepared that in all likelihood, we'll be advocating for a budget that's higher than what was presented to the Finance Committee.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a fair statement?
Yep.
So you're up.
Thank you very much. I wanted to present to you a little bit more information before you start deliberating. In the packet, we did add some additional information based on a lot of the conversations that we've been having at the meetings. The answers to your questions have been included in the updated packet. These slides, and I do have one additional slide, which I didn't include, which I will show you this evening, which takes a glimpse at FY18. I also want to recognize the work that's been done to put this budget together by our principals, central office administrators, budget parents who have been attending the different meetings. You know, as I mentioned here in the very first night, I use the term recommended loosely this year because in a perfect world, I would love to present to you a level service budget. But given the fiscal constraints of our community, this is the best we can present. We also looked very carefully at how we were going to get from a level service budget to this base budget and the reductions that needed to be made. And we carefully made those reductions based on what we feel would have the least amount of impact on students. And so I'm going to show you some additional information slides tonight, and then we can certainly open it up to any additional questions you may have. So the first thing I want to show you, and I did present this the other night to at the Finance Committee, the Financial Forum, is, as we all know, it takes a lot more than the general operating budget to run our schools. So in FY17, the breakdown of the budget is the operating guidance from FinCom, which you see there, plus the additional $150,000, which will fund the first year of science implementation in our school district. We anticipate it'll be a three-year implementation. There's also revolving fund offsets, and we've had a lot of conversations about revolving funds at the school committee meetings. And in the updated budget book that you also received, and I think you have the pages in front of you, the extra pages, Ms. Seibert did put more narrative into those revolving accounts and updated and revised the chart to further clarify what each of the categories of revolving accounts were so that you'd have a better explanation of those. We also have circuit breaker, and as you know, we use the FY16 circuit breaker offset for the FY17 budget. This gives us budget certainty as we move forward. And then we have our grant awards, which are pretty much all federal grants, the IDA grant, the school transformation grant, and some other grants. So really, it's more of a $46 million budget to run our school district with all of those additional revenue sources that we need to maintain some of the services that are in our school district. There are other funds that are not included in the budget, and last year you accepted $160,000 in donations, which are used in a variety of ways, from programs to professional development to a musical instrument at schools, technology. And so, you know, those are things that help supplement the things that we're trying to do in our schools. And then on top of that, which that's an estimate, we have our PTOs and the enormous work that our PTOs and our other groups do to raise funds to help support enrichment activities and other other materials and activities in our different schools. And conservatively, that's about $240,000. So you can see there's a lot of resources that go into maintaining and running the schools. I know there's been some questions also about professional development, so I want to break this down further. So the way that the DESE categorizes professional development, it isn't just what we think of as professional development, which is workshops or conferences or things like that. The DESE actually breaks down professional development in a variety of categories. So when you see the line for professional development, it actually is broken down into several areas. One is tuition reimbursement, which is contractual in three of our collective bargaining units, the teachers, the paraeducators, and the secretaries. And there is a cap on each of those. This year, we've already reached the teacher cap on tuition reimbursement in a specific contractual language on how that tuition reimbursement can be applied. We also have curriculum leader stipends, which help provide leadership in our PLCs. In other areas, but the curriculum leader stipend line item also has the virtual high school participation stipends. We do subscribe to virtual high school, and we use virtual high school in a couple of ways. One is it provides online courses for students to access courses that we don't have available to us. And it's mostly at the high school, though we do have some middle school students in the past that have taken virtual high school or virtual middle school, I guess you'd call it. But we also this year eliminated a line item for what's called Play-Doh, and we weaved that into our virtual high school participation. Play-Doh is an online flexible course program for students that are in transition back into our schools, either are being hospitalized and they're coming back from hospitalization, or they may be school phobic and we're trying to ease their way back into schools. And so we have several students that are taking virtual high school as a flexible course option as well. We would also use it, and we've not had to do this yet, if we have a student that's on a long-term suspension, we could also use virtual high school for that, as we are required to provide educational services for students that are on suspension by law. District-wide PD, which has actually been going down over the last several years, really is the amount of funds that we have at the district level to provide professional development workshop support to our teachers K through 12. So you could see that over the last 2 years, that line has been in 31,000 and 38,000. This is the line that we restructured the coaches from. And so you don't see the coaches under professional development because it would be, I believe it's called instructional staff or instructional coaching staff, and that's in a different line item. Stipends for PD work. These are, I believe, the assistant principals at the elementary school. Mm-hmm. We do have a stipend given at each of our five elementary schools to have an assistant principal. It's not the assistant principals at the secondary level. These are teachers who receive a small stipend for doing some work to help support our elementary principals. You can see the last three items, conference, workshop, PD expenses, general ed, and professional development, those three come from the building-based budgets. So those are the per pupil amounts that we've talked about at these meetings, so that principals allocate some of their funding to some of these areas so that they can provide building-based support for teachers, if a teacher wants to go to a workshop or they want to bring someone in to work with a group of teachers at the building level for something that may not be district specific. So that's how it's broken down It looks like a big number, but when you break it down across the areas, really the only true quote-unquote PD in terms of workshops and in professional development that we know of is out of the district-wide PD, and that's, you could see, a $38,750. These are the virtual high school numbers, and you can see we made a switch in the model with virtual high school. We have begun to advertise virtual high school more, and as I mentioned, we are also using this as a flexible course option. And you can see that we've had an increase in enrollment. Last semester, which just completed, we had 34 students out of the 40 seats available. Spring, it's currently at 16, but that will go up. We just started the second semester. So just wanted to show you that we are maximizing it. This is an area that I think we're going to see more and more as time go on. It will be on the increase.
How many students were in the Plato? Can you share that, or is that?
I'm not sure the exact number, but it's probably about half. It's probably about 17, around 15 to 17.
Yes.
Would you like questions at the end, or kind
no,
of?
No, I can take a minute.
Why was there such a dip in enrollment in FY15? I see the big increase this year, but it almost looks like from 14 to 15 there was a dip.
We were in transition with this model, and I also think that it may not have been well publicized that we had this option available.
Okay. And just one more follow-up on that. Can you explain how the increased enrollment has led to a need for increased stipends for teachers? So what's the connection?
So
I don't understand.
It's part of the contract with VHS. In order to get to get 40 slots, you have to have teachers teach online courses.
That explains.
So in order to have them teach online courses, we provide a stipend. We did not have a stipend. We've eliminated the stipend. We put it back in once
the demand was there.
Right.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Can I just clarify? So I thought that that's part of what happened in 14-15 was we eliminated the stipend, so we weren't really getting the slots with the teacher stipends. And then if kids wanted to take the virtual high school, we would pay a fee for the class.
Correct.
So we had changed that. We basically flipped that, and I think it was, and then weren't really kind of encouraging that. But I think it's really important that we need to address some high school scheduling things also to allow students to really take full advantage of this. So I don't know whether it's some students may take it in a outside of school, some may take them in during the day.
Yeah, it provides options for them to
I think it's something that we've been working on for a while, and that clearly that switch to the other model really didn't do what we needed it to do, but we were cutting PD.
Just along those lines, when you said we're doing a better job of promoting it or advertising, who does that? Is it guidance? Is it individual teachers? Is it?
It's guidance.
It's guidance. Okay.
It's in the course handbook also.
Yeah, it's in the course handbook as well.
Yeah, but if you want to bring it to people's attention, I'm sure it's in the book. But it's also nice to, reach out to a student and say, hey, I think this is a great option for you. Just if you really bring it to someone's attention as opposed to just reading in a book, I think that will help, get the conversation going.
Yes.
I just wanted to say that this virtual high school enables, it's both helpful for children that might have difficulty coming into school, but it also enables students to go outside of what we are otherwise able to offer.
Right.
My daughter was able to follow through on her American Sign Language learning because of this virtual high school, and we were very grateful for that, and she has continued with that learning because there was this bridge.
So another area I wanted to emphasize a little bit more is the increase that we made this year in building per pupil allocation. Last year in the current budget, the FY16 budget, we made a reduction in the per pupil. You could see there at the elementary level and the middle school level is $130 per student. At the high school level is $150 per student. That's currently. And the reason why we did that and reduced it from the FY15 levels was we wanted to make reductions so that we could save personnel in this current budget. We also said at the time that that was something we could only do for 1 year, that the way that our purchasing cycle works, we do a lot of our purchasing at the end of one fiscal year, which carries us into the next fiscal year. So we could take a reduction this year, but we would have to next year go back to the full amounts. And the building per pupil allocation essentially funds all of the day-to-day operations of the school, ranging from the rental of the copying machines to the workbooks that the students have to some technology purchases that may be specific to a building, to materials, supplies, paper, pencils, all of those things. That's all done at the building level with this amount of money. So in FY17, we proposed bringing it back up to the FY15 levels, and you can see the percent increases. Now, the building principal, when they submit their budgets to us, take the amount of money that is being allocated, and then they put it into, actually, I should go to this one here. Here we go. So then they begin to allocate it in the different line items that you see in your budget book. So you are going to see in the budget book, and I know this question came up a few times, you're going to see some unusual increases this year, and that's because of the increase in the overall per pupil. So I wanted to make sure I highlighted that so that you saw that that's why you see a lot of increases in these areas. It's because of the additional per pupil funding that's been allocated this year, which is about $100,000.
$96,000.
It's $96,000 more than last year. Okay.
So with the, in prior years when we reduced, or I don't think we fully eliminated, have we eliminated it totally? Or
oh, no, we've never eliminated it. We have reduced it to
reduce the per pupil amounts. We still had to fund things that you just, like you, the example you use, copier leases and stuff. Someone still had to pay that.
It came out of the building budget.
Right.
Okay. And this just shows the, over the last several fiscal years, the amount that has been allocated to each building. And it does fluctuate a little bit based on enrollment. So there's an amount times the enrollment that's the October 1st enrollment from that year. So that's how the number is calculated.
All right, so those percentages, So these percentages, like 31%, that number is below the FY13 number, actually, but it's an increase from 16, and there could have been an enrollment increase that's also driving that to look like a huge number.
Right. Right, because Barrows did have
25.
Yeah. The next two slides that I wanted to show you is we've actually had to make reductions and offset increases over the last several budgets, and so I wanted to just give you a snapshot of what this looks like. So, in the first line here, these are the amount that we've reduced the budget over the last several fiscal years, and this is what's proposed for this fiscal year. The offset increases that have been recommended in the superintendent's budget over the last several years, and the cumulative amount, and then the total for each of the fiscal years. And here's the budget percent increase during those times. And so you can see that every year we have had we've done combinations of budget reductions and or offset increases to get to the recommended number that has been put forward each year. So the reason why I'm showing this slide is that this is, because I know this has come up a couple, not by the committee, but by the public, is that, why are we at the point where we're cutting people and personnel and positions? It's because we've been doing a lot of the reductions and offset increases already over the last several fiscal years. And finally, we're at a point where we can no longer sustain any of this without making personnel cuts. When you look at this slide here, I know it may be difficult to see, but here is some of the things that we have reduced in each of the different fiscal years. In FY14, We made some reductions to paraeducator hours. We made reductions in FY15 at the middle school level. That was the health teacher. And at the high school level, we made some reductions that year. We also made reductions in some stipends and paraeducator hours in FY16. Substitute teacher funding, which we did not restore in this current budget. And in FY16, we did some restructuring. You can see here. We also, down below, these are all the offset increases that we've done over the last several years, and then the cumulative amount on the right-hand side. So we've done everything we can through the last several fiscal years, and now we're at a point where we really don't have a lot of other options, which is why the budget that we're presenting today has more personnel reductions than in past years. And it really is because of, you know, and it was said at I believe the financial forum that we have a revenue problem. We do not have a spending problem. I know it was said, I think it was one of the Board of Selectmen that said that. So I wanted to give you a glimpse into FY18. A year ago, I gave you a glimpse into FY17. And what I said a year ago is that if we had a 2.75% increase and we moved everything forward, that we'd be cutting about $900,000 in this year's budget. Well, we got a 3.25% increase, so the reduction wasn't as drastic as $900,000. But if we're looking at FY18, and the town manager said the other night that right now it looks like it's a 1% increase next year in our operating budgets for FY18, that would be about a $408,000 increase in our budget for next year, for FY18. And so when you take a look at what that would be, the operating budget would then be at $41,256,143. The estimated expenses, and the way that we came up with that, is essentially we moved everything forward with the current increases. And again, this is a complete back-of-the-envelope estimate, but I think it gives you a glimpse that if everything stays the same, we have a 1% increase in our budget in FY18, we're looking at a $1.8 million reduction.
I appreciate that. I guess the only thing that I caution is that will be a new year for a new collective bargaining agreement, the first year of. So what we're in the third year of now, so it may not be anything near
correct
plus or minus, you know?
Correct. I just think it's important to note that the problem is going to get worse. It's not going to get better, which I think we know, but I wanted to show that. So.
Well, I think it's important, and you know, a lot of discussion about the revolving accounts, because we have to really, you know, understand where we are and be able to say, you know, there's some good reasons why, and historical reasons and, you know, projective reasons why we may say, no, we have to leave that revolving account where it is. I think this is part of understanding that. And so, you know, I appreciate that.
So just to put a conclusion, as you know, that this budget is below level service. It represents, you know, for the third consecutive year, and we have great concerns about FY18. The budget, though, that is presented to you aligns with the goals of the district, and that's always very important in what we're trying to do. It keeps most class sizes within the recommended levels. It provides for progress in key areas. There is funding here for a science curriculum. It builds capacity of our teachers during this transition that we're going through with new curriculum and assessment systems. It supports teachers in, you know, best we can. And it minimizes, and this is the important point, the impact on student programs and student achievement outcomes. So although it is not a great budget, we are able to still do some of the things that we feel we need to do as a district. So that wraps up my...
Did you want to go over the questions, or is that...
Well, you have the questions in front of you. I don't know if there's any specific questions you want us to highlight. I know there's 51 questions.
Yeah. just threw that out.
Yeah. We'll be more than happy to clarify any of the answers that we've presented to you.
Yes.
So I just, your last slide up there, Dr. Doherty, in terms of keeping most class sizes within the recommended levels, I know that we have, I think, all of our elementary principals or interim principals here tonight, along with Principal Baca of the high school. So this is a lot of pressure because I'm looking at my friends. But I just, you know, I think we established those class sizes, I don't remember what year, but shortly after Pat came on board, after Harry Aratunian left. And my children were, my 22-year-olds were not 22 then, and it was, the class sizes were quite high, and it took the committee quite a number of years to sort of get them into these, the goal areas that we're in now. And so I know we've looked at sort of where those are, and while it's not going to be where we really want it to be for 3 to 5, we have great goal numbers, better than other districts. I recognize we're not going to make it, but you know, we got through that in the, I don't know, 2000s, early 2000s. And the class sizes at Killam were in third grade 27, 28, and 29. And you know, there was a lot of support from the community, the parent community, and sort of classroom helpers. And you know, I don't know, with all the Corey fingerprinting stuff, whether we can really do that as effectively as we did it then. But it, you know, it helped, and there was recognition that this was going to be, you know, not optimal, but people worked together to get through it. And you know, honestly, you know, let's just hope that the, you know, FY18 is not what the current projection would have it be, because that would be a lot different. So you know, I think that while you'd want to
thank you,
not see that impact, I just think we're doing the best we can, and I think, you know, maybe there's some way to have some, that's what we did, the parents chipped in. There were no paraeducators available, you know, those resources weren't there. It was really slim. But, you know, if it helps the teachers, if that's what they think will help with them, I'm sure the parent community will be willingly step up in any way. But unfortunately, I think that's where we are. But at least it's not 27, 28, 29.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any more?
Yes. I just want to add a little bit of color, and I in no way mean to diminish the seriousness of the fiscal outlook, because it is very, very serious. But on your slide where you talked about all of the cuts that we've made over the last several years, mm-hmm. I do think it's important to point out that in many cases, and this is an absolute testament to the administrative team, those positions were restructured. So yes, these cuts all happened, but last year we added 2 instructional coaches. And in your proposed budget this year, we're adding a social worker to support some of our most vulnerable elementary students. It's maybe a bit of a silver lining, but I think it's important to point out that while we're working with incredibly challenging resource situations, we're still, and again, a testament to the administrative team, finding ways to fund positions that didn't exist a year ago or 2 years ago that are vital to moving the district forward. So I just want to add that little bit of color to that slide. Thank you.
Yes.
I also wanted to add about the extra 100, and it's not extra, but the 150,000 that we're requesting for the No Adams Science program, that I think our district has time and time again used a collaborative process to figure out what curriculum would be the most effective for our students. And this, our teachers have been piloting No Adam and being trained it and giving their feedback for it. And I really think it's important for us to go forward with it and educate the town about the importance of going forward with it, because science education has not stood still. And I think that the science education now is not the same as it was 25 years ago. And so I think it's really important that we do this for our children and our teachers so that we can keep moving forward.
If I just want to clarify just that we have not made a decision yet on if this funding is approved on what we're doing. We are piloting No Adam right now, but I don't want people to get the perception that that's what we're doing. I just want to clarify that.
Apologies.
I mean, we've had a lot of positive, you know, results with the No Adam that we're hearing from teachers and parents and students, but we have not made a decision yet if we're going to move forward what we would use.
John, can you, as we're talking about the science, can you give some sense for, you and I have talked a little bit about this, give some sense for, because the $150,000 is year one.
Right.
And what we're talking about over, I think it's a three-year period, and, you know, I don't know whether it's the right word, but, and I look at, you know, years two and three, that amount being sacrosanct, because I don't want to spend $150,000 one year and then have someone come to me and say, we got to cut that down the road. So can you give a sense for that?
Sure. And I can also have Craig chip in with the more of the details, but the state is going to be approving some new frameworks this month at their board meeting, which they have spent 3 years analyzing, getting feedback on, and so they're ready to move forward with the new science standards. So it actually puts us in a good position to start phasing in a three-year rollout. The first year, and the costs that we're talking about are durable good costs, curriculum material costs, not consumables, because science is the type of subject area that is going to have ongoing consumable costs, just given the nature, it's a very hands-on subject. So the first year, we're looking at doing some three grades at elementary and 1 year in middle school. Year two would be similar. You'd be doing three grades at elementary the second year of middle school. And then you'd be focusing in year three on the third year of middle school and the high school. And what we're looking at as an estimate is approximately $150,000 a year.
Okay.
And Craig can go into more detail about, unless...
I mean, I think that you really hit it all.
Yeah.
I mean, as John said earlier, I mean, our teachers are still assessing. Generally, we've been pretty pleased at the elementary level. It may look different at the middle level and certainly at the high school level. And we have teachers right now, for instance, at the middle level, looking at various programs. I mean, they've already realized ways that their curriculum will need to shift to align with the standards in a more integrated way. And so they're already on board with that and looking at that. But as Dr. Doherty said, the first year expenses tends to be the, you know, the teacher materials, the, you know, books, licenses, durable goods, that the first year expense is the highest. So that's what we're looking to sort of roll out over a three-year period.
Yes.
If you would indulge me to go just a teeny bit off of budget talk, because we're talking science, how does that impact? I believe the science MCAS is fifth and eighth grade. Has the state articulated how that would, the assessments for science will change based on their new frameworks? Is there a time frame for that? Can we expect them to be very different?
Yes. They're going to slowly transition, and in 3 years, they will be fully implementing the standards in the assessment.
Okay.
I'm not sure yet in terms of what the assessment will look like. My guess is it will look much different than the current MCAS.
But it's a three-year window. Implement the new standards.
That's what we've been told.
Three
yes.
years to begin getting up to speed, and then the new assessments will
Correct.
Be in place. Okay. Thank you.
Another science question. So I was just, as we're talking about science, I have some questions about what really drives the high school curriculum, and wondering also about, you know, the Bernier, all the is it Bernier lab equipment that was implemented 2 years
mm-hmm.
ago, whether, you know, that's expanding. And again, I was really thinking about what drives the frameworks are at the high school level as well, and so that will drive changes to the science curriculum at the high school. in addition to the AP, I was wondering, the AP must sort of drive it back too, in terms of curriculum. But, and just wanting to, you know, the 150, is a piece of that is for the high school as well? Is that true?
Year three.
Year three?
Year three.
Okay, oh, so this is really elementary and some middle this year?
No.
Sorry.
Yes, so this year, next year,
yeah.
Next year would be three grades in elementary and grade six.
Okay.
The following year would be the rest of the elementary, grade seven. And then the third year would be grade eight in the high school.
Okay. I'm just wondering about, you know, in between, it's in between, it's the the work that we do with the, like the PLCs and in the departments in terms of looking at student outcomes and feedback. You know, formative assessments and, you know, the standardized assessments. So, you know, unfortunately, I know people were asking questions about why, you know, why are we spending this $150,000 now? And the answer is because it's like we have just reached the end on not spending this money and investing it in the science curriculum. And the results, you know, results are showing that. And, you know, I think we need to just really allocate that. And in my mind, it's not. Well, do you do that, or do you add two elementary teachers? It's not. You can't really do that apples to apples. So I think this has just been a long time coming, and I really appreciate what Chairman Robinson said in terms of, you know, we need that commitment. I think. So again, right around the time Pat came in as a superintendent, there had been prior to that, actually, John, you're probably a science teacher. A number of curriculum attempts and changes where we sort of did the first year and got people and teachers engaged and did the work. They did the hard work and invested themselves in, you know, evaluating this curriculum. This is great for kids. And then, boom, we don't have that funding. Stop. I think we did that in, like, my memory at least two or three times. And so then we had this time period where it's like, okay, well, we're not going to do anything because if we can't actually, you know, afford it and commit to it, and make a stand for it, then we're not going to start it. And that is how I think we got where we are with the science, because we basically said, well, we can't make a stand for it, we're not going to start it.
I think that's very fair.
So
we also hit a time where we then became aware that the standards were probably going to shift and upgrade it, and then we thought it's not worth a major investment until we know exactly what we want to align for. But, and then, you know, with what you just said, it's now a decade or more later, and Pluto used to be a planet.
Oh, my
God. Yes.
If I may, I know I'm the third person to reiterate this, but I think it is, I completely agree with you, Mr. Chair, that I don't look at this as a $150,000 investment. I look at it as a $450,000 investment over 3 years, and the level of transparency to the Finance Committee and town meeting needs to be very clear on that, that it would be devastating to the system to get 150, start the implementation, and then in year two not be able to move forward. So the commitment has to be there for the full 5 years. And it certainly did come up in the community, what is the driving force behind this? And I just would like to add that on the budget book on page 64, you can see our grade 5 and grade 8 science and technology MCAS scores over the last several years. And while the needs improvement have been relatively steady, the level of proficient scores are going up, the level of advanced scores are going down. So what that says to me is that we are, kids who were previously performing at the top level are falling back. So this isn't so much about supporting the neediest learners as much as realizing that our kids aren't reaching the advanced level as well as peer districts are. So I've personally found this compelling evidence for the need for it.
Just a quick one, getting back to, you know, all of the cuts that are being made, and to Elaine's point about reaching out to the parent community. I know that there's been some concern about the cutback of after-school hours at the library, and I think it would be really important to try to engage the high school PTO as soon as possible to see if there's a way that they can work with the administration and really fund that extra hour that's very important to teachers. I think the PTOs are terrific and they're willing to help with anything, so let's get to them if this budget passes as soon as possible to see if we can make a plan so we don't lose that hour.
Already done.
Great. I love
Thank
it.
You. Yeah, I guess that. Thanks for bringing that up. That's a good point. I think I'm speaking for myself. I, as I said at the outset, I support what's been brought to us. But having said that, I also heard loud and clear from the, the students and some of the parents for the Latin program. And, I'm supporting this with the understanding that we'll find a way to continue that. And also, while we didn't hear from as many, we did hear a lot from the library hours. And I know there's a plan to try and do that. I think it's 1 hour a day.
Yes.
2:30 to 3:30, yeah.
2:30, 3:30. Yeah, they did verbally agree informally to help support to continue that hour after school. So I'm fortunate and grateful for that.
Yes.
So I guess on this, the topic of sort of the high school and sort of the approach with sort of reduction of FTEs and looking at the schedule, I think, I know that there's some, issues with maybe needing tools and needing time to really look at the high school schedule, and that we need to, maximize the enrollment so that, we can achieve this reduction. So I think we've talked, you can't have 15 students in a ninth grade English class. You've got to figure out how you take the two classes and you've got 26 or whatever number. But I think it's really challenging, and I'm sure that one of the reasons those kinds of things can happen too is because you're trying to provide all of the classes that all of the kids want, and it can't always work when you have the ability to have additional sections, even though they're small. Well, then maybe you make that work more times, or maybe we need to. In terms of sort of the whole high school schedule, we really need to be looking at that and seeing if we could do something different that would help us optimize that. But I just want to sort of acknowledge that we're going to try to distribute this right in a manner so that we're not cutting a program. But I think we have to recognize that there's going to be impacts, and there's going to be people and parents who come September are probably going to send us emails and say, I don't understand why I can't do, my son or daughter can't do everything that they want to do, because they all should be able to do everything they want to do, but we can't do it. We don't have the capacity. And so I just sort of want to acknowledge that. I know we've talked, that you end up sometimes with those small classes with the AP classes because and unfortunately, we don't have 30 kids in AP Physics. But so you might end up with a smaller class, but you've got one section of that. But again, multiple sections, allows you to massage and work the schedules to get so the kids can get every class they want. But that's just not possible in this situation. So I just sort of want to acknowledge that. The cuts are going to be spread across, and, we're going to have some impacts. Because they're going to sit with a guidance counselor, and the guidance counselor is going to say, here, you look at what I see. You look at what do you want to not do so that you can do that class? Because that's where that class is. And so that's where we are. And, hopefully we'll start to make a path towards being in a different place sometime in the near future.
I guess... in terms of what I was trying to say with the Latin is, I don't think that's a want. That's something that they have that we're taking away, or we were proposing to take away. And, the way I understood it is we'll relook at it and figure out a way not to take it away.
Yeah, the reduction is not going to be Latin teacher.
No, I agree with that, but I mean, I think what it comes down to when you spread that across, and the way that you do that is because you're going to be able to optimize the use of your teachers and not have maybe some smaller sections. You're going to end up with a student who, in order to get that engineering class, let's just not say Latin, let's say engineering because that's my level, point, but they can't get into that engineering class because that engineering class is only offered we're only offering one section this year. We pulled rabbits out of hats that didn't exist to offer a second section of principles of engineering, I think, or intro engineering. But now there'll be one. And so, you know, if there's fewer options of 11th grade English and you want that engineering class, but you're also trying to take, you know, it's complicated. You're trying to take a honors chemistry or AP bio. It's going to come down to you can't do that because we don't have that additional section of engineering, or it might even be English that, you know, becomes the rubbing point. You know, these are the three English sections we have. You have to be in one of those. What don't you want to do, you know, in your schedule? And I'm just saying that's the reality of the complexities of the high school schedule. And, you know, Latin will be a choice. Latin will still be a choice. So for a student who that's really important for their fourth year, the kids that came to us that say, I really want to continue this. I want to get my 4 years. They're going to make it a priority, right, that their schedule puts them in that class. And then everything else has to fit.
Yeah, but I'm sorry. You can't I'm comparing what is a graduation requirement, which is a foreign language. Some things you mentioned may be electives. That's different as far as I'm concerned.
It even happens with the sciences, though, too. I mean, I think do we have 4 years of a science? 4 years of science.
Yeah. We have 3 years now as a requirement for most colleges, but for graduation requirements, it's three.
Yeah, I think we have to focus on what are the graduation requirements? What are the most important things? And then students will have to make a decision. No, I can't do that, you know, whatever it is, photography or engineering. I can't do it. You know, I have to stick to making sure that I get my calculus, my language, my math, you know. Just saying this, it's going to spread across and it's going to be challenging.
You read my mind. I hadn't gotten my hand up yet. I was engaged. Mrs. Webb kept mentioning the rabbits out of the hats, and I think we have a wall full of people here that have been pulling rabbits out of the hat and making things work so that for years we haven't felt the cuts as badly. You've been able to make it work, and our administration has been able to figure out ways for the least impact on students. I think there are a number of things that I just choke on in this budget, but the realization, like Mrs. Webb was saying, is that we're at a place where it's the least impact on our students, not that it's a good impact on our students or it's a good choice. And I would point out too that we have this vibrant library in the high school that's a great space, not just for academic and technological learning, but also for a release where kids can go and work together in groups and escape some of the pressure of the school and be together. And we're compromising by taking away our para in that space because the library I lost her title, but the person.
Library aide.
Thank you. No, not the library aide. The
library media specialist.
Yes, thank you. Library media specialist is going to be pulled in a lot of directions, given that she has to monitor the equipment and keep track of the kids that come in and be on call for teachers that need her. And I think that she juggles a lot of things, and it's definitely going to make it more challenging not to have an aide in that space. But when you look at the least impact on the students, you know, these are really tough decisions that are being made. And I guess I want to put out there a challenge too, is that up till now, people have been very creative in meeting the needs of our students, and I think that I can feel confident saying that that's not going to stop, that there'll still be people working together to make the best of a bad situation or a difficult, very difficult situation. And so going forward, I just hope people recognize the difficult situation we're in and the amount of energy and expertise that's being put into trying to keep it from being a desperate situation, but still a positive situation for our students going forward.
It actually touches on both of the comments that Mrs. Webb and Dr. Doxer just said. Mrs. Webb, you talked about the high school challenges, and there are definitely revenue reasons why that's going to be challenging, but there's some non-revenue reasons, and that gets to high school graduation requirements. And so I think that there's been a very impressive balance between we can't do these things because we don't have the revenue to do them. On the other hand, what can we do? And I would point to Ms. Wilson's presentation a few months ago on the Walker Report, where you acknowledge there are several recommendations in here we currently don't have the budget to do. But we can get good job descriptions. We can have exit and entrance requirements. We can restructure a position that was in the budget, I believe, and add team chairs instead, because it turns out that's the need. So this really reiterates what Dr. Doxer was saying. There's a tremendous amount of creativity and flexibility in managing with what we've got to improve a lot of areas. So it's impressive.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, there's two things that I wanted to add. I had a conversation with Mr. Nyan today, and he brought up two areas that I want to make sure that I capture. I hope he's watching. So he did have expressed some concerns about the wellness department chair getting reduced, and he brought up two areas that were very concerning to him that he thought could fall by the wayside, which I looked into this afternoon. One being the maintaining of the fitness center, which is something that is used after school. And the other is to make sure that our challenge course, which is the outside course on that hill, mm-hmm. Is also keeps up with state regulations and is kept safe and is also maintained. So in terms of the fitness center, we do budget an amount of funding each year for staff to run the fitness center 3 days a week after school for an hour and a half. There is also funding in there that we would be able to provide a stipend to oversee the fitness center to make sure that equipment is maintained, to make sure that when there is faulty equipment, that we're taking it offline and that we're getting it repaired. So there is funding in the amount that we already have budgeted to be able to handle that. In terms of the challenge course, I had a conversation with Joe Huggins today. We currently contract out with a company that goes through entire safety checks of all of our challenge course equipment, and that will continue. That's budgeted for. We would just need someone to oversee that, and facility said that they have no problem working with the company to make sure that we get the certificate done correctly, we're following all state safety regulations, and making sure that everything is up to speed. And this is something that they do in other areas already, our facilities department. So we're able to address those two issues that I know the PE wellness department chair was overseeing.
On the just thought of a question when you brought that up, the wellness center.
The fitness center?
Fitness center.
Yep.
What about when, like, I know a lot of the seasons the coaches are in there with the teams. Do we still have someone else in there at the same time?
So the way the fitness center operates, my understanding, is that 3 days a week it's open from, I think, 2:30 to 4 for the general student population, and then the teams go in at 4 o'clock with the coach. That's my understanding.
You have something you wanted to
public comment.
You want to come up just so we can get you on the. Sorry, I didn't mean to embarrass you.
Mr. Robinson, thank you for your time. I shared some points that I'll briefly summarize here with Mr. Robinson. You're welcome to share those with the others on the board by email today. I'm a first-year budget parent. I'm new to this process. I appreciate there's a lot of complexity. Dr. Daugherty has been very patient in explaining a lot of the process to all of us who are just starting. There are four items in the budget that are particularly troubling to me, actually just four lines. They're here in the handout today. Unfortunately, not tremendously legible, and I don't have page numbers, but I'll hold it up on TV, this one. So it's the FTE cuts to teachers that are very troubling to me. There's three line items here. Three of the four that trouble me here are on this page that I pointed out. They're just the reductions to the elementary, middle, and high school teachers. We've talked about the high school teacher. I have children in the elementary school. In the future, I expect to have children in the middle school. So one of the things that I notice is the increase in student-teacher ratios as you move up into some of the middle schools within Reading. The amount that we're saving with these proposed cuts is comparatively small, in my opinion. It's on the order of, Dr. Daugherty, I think it's about 400,000. I think it's about 6.9 FTE or 5.9, 6 to 7.
I think it's 5, yeah, I think it's 5.9.
5.9, okay, so around 6, you're losing about 6 FTE, and it's a combination, I get, of reducing some hours, and you're not necessarily firing 6 people. But there's nothing that prevents people from being let go in the event that that's what's needed to balance our budget. To save 1% that way, to me, seems like a step in the wrong direction. It seems like a bell you can't unring. I foresee three possible consequences of that. One is obviously less access to teachers. That's not going to help any student learn. Two, another consequence would be possibly to teacher morale. Hey, if I don't know who's, you know, how these FTEs are going to be distributed, these reductions, whether I'm going to lose time or I'm going to lose my job, you're creating an incentive for anyone to look at other opportunities in other districts. That's not something that I think we want to be doing. And then lastly, of course, it makes it harder to attract people to the district, feeling that there's an uncertainty about whether their position will be maintained year over year, particularly when they're new to the teaching force. So, you know, what I would propose is that, and this may or may not be allowed, but this is the fourth line. If we turn the page, two pages forward, I noticed when we look at, I believe these are revolving accounts, revolving funds, I noticed that, you know, in the line, so it's this slide, and we're going to this page with all the text. Okay, so there's a line here that got my attention. It just said that there is no statute that mandates a specified ending balance for these four funds. The fund in particular that got my attention on the next page here was the Extended Day Fund. Extended Day is a fantastic service. My wife and I have availed ourselves of this program. It's good. It's not inexpensive, but it is very helpful for parents. You have a starting balance there of $866,000. So the teaching cuts, remember, we're adding up to about half that, to about $400,000. We're projecting revenues of $1.15 million with about $1 million in expected expenses. You have a fairly stable revenue stream projected out here, $1 million and rising. You have fairly stable costs, and you're sitting on $866,000 in the bank account. I'm not saying we take the $387,000 or $90,000 you get from these FTEs directly out of this, but this is, in my mind, jumped off the page as one example where you would have less risk to students. I get that enrollment is unpredictable and that you have a fixed cost of $1 million going out the door, according to these numbers, to pay the people and facilities involved. But just consider whether this is a place where you could get back some of those FTEs and whether there are other places where even we are not contractually obligated to a certain payment obligations under contracts, be it for teachers or maintenance or what have you. If you take all the non-contractually required spending and put it to one side and you look at what's left over, if you cut that by 1%, what would that look like in order to keep these teachers at full-time equivalent? So thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
You're correct. There is no statutory requirement that we have to keep them at a certain level, but we don't. We'll just use the extended day for an example. We can't utilize those funds to just do anything in the budget. If we're utilizing that offset, it has to go towards that program. So we can't just start going to different revolving accounts to fund things that aren't associated with them. I don't know if that, does that make sense?
You're the expert. I'm new to the process. Appreciate your time then. My point is that there may be money in other places that wouldn't, I can, you know, the potential harm to students of taking teachers away seems pretty clear to me. The potential harm from risking not having a revenue stream that you expect in order to pay something that is not involved in direct student contact or meeting the learning needs of students, to me, that's a risk I, as a taxpayer, am more willing to take. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
No, I think you said it correctly. The revolving accounts can only be used for certain purposes.
I actually did. I really appreciate your concern, and I think that I know I can speak for myself. I hate the idea of cutting back on the FTDs and the teachers. I think, though, that what I've also realized is that teachers need support as well as we need teachers. So when we take away those supports, if we don't have clerical in special ed, or we don't have a team leader in special ed, or we don't have the curriculum resources, we might be keeping the teachers, but we might be tying their hands behind their back as well. And that the burnout factor for our devoted teachers who are trying to do the best job that they can, if they don't have the resources that they need to do that job, then they're also, I believe they also burn out and are in a very difficult situation. So I think that I hate cutting FTEs, but I sort of see us as a system and that we need to support our teachers as well as have our teachers here. And so it's such a hard situation to be in, and I really appreciate the creativity that's been put into this budget to minimize the harsh cuts that we're looking at. Because I don't think it's not a recommended budget. It's the least painful budget as opposed. So I completely understand the desire not to cut any teachers. I just think we have to keep supporting the ones we have too.
So I think, along those lines, I think we've really dug deep in terms of using the offsets. And the other area that it just strikes me is we budgeted for one less out of district. Right, is it 58,000? Is that the right number?
55,800.
Yeah. 55,800.
Yep. So typically, I would say, we've definitely tried not to do that because it's sort of, you don't know exactly who's coming, but you look at that past history, and I know, so this year, we're probably, I think that, we've taken a calculated risk by not doing that. We've been very transparent that we're not doing that. But by doing that, we've given ourselves 55,800.
Yeah. Essentially a teacher's salary.
Right, so that we could avoid a cut. Right. I mean, and that's a real challenge for us when we do our budget. Also, the same aspects exist in the municipal budgeting process as well. I'm really glad we did that. Are we taking a little bit of a risk? We are. And, that would be, if something does happen, we're going to have to go back and have some discussions with, finance committee and town meeting. But it did allow us to avoid one cut, basically. So I think we've just done those things where we could.
I think you're absolutely spot on with your potential consequences of doing it. Having said that, I can with great confidence know that those conversations were had with the people that crafted the budget that came to us. While, as I think it was said, it was a loosely recommended budget, there's a comfort level. I think now with the, for instance, the elementary grades 3 through 5, the class sizes would be
24, 25.
It's not great, but we can may handle that for another year or so until we figure out what we're going to do. So I guess if I ever felt like the budget that was being presented, and I'm speaking for myself, that there was no confidence in it and that things were bad things were going to happen, then I couldn't support it. But I guess I haven't felt that. I've heard the concerns with it, but not that you know, it's going to get that bad right away. That I'm rambling on here, but I don't know if that makes sense. I do agree with your concerns, but I do have confidence with what that was well vetted before it ever got to this table. Did you have
no?
Does anyone did? Yes.
Just to your point about it being well vetted, just to reiterate that we had our administrative teams, including principals, and people from the schools involved in creating this loosely recommended budget. So it wasn't just coming from the top down. It was a real collaborative effort, and that helps me feel positive and more optimistic about going forward, because we're all working together on this.
Thank you. Anyone else? Any other questions on the budget?
Mr. Chair, move to approve the FY 2017 school committee approved budget in the total amount of $40,847,666, consisting of the following cost center amounts. Administration, $963,694. Regular day, $24,860,947. Special education, $12,223,473. Apologize. Other, $1,608,042. School facilities, $1,191,510.
Second.
Second.
Is there any other discussion? Did you have something?
I just want to say that I really appreciate all the work of the administration, Dr. Daugherty, Ms. Seibert, Carolyn, Craig Martin, and really all the principals, and also really all of the committee members. I think that this is not the fun part. Graduation is the fun part. And the great sort of elementary and middle school programs that we get to attend as your guests. But certainly, being able to work through this with people that are so focused on the goal, and the goal is about the students. And hopefully we as a community can really embrace that in the months to come. So thank you for all the hard work.
Thank you.
Yes.
And I'm going to go one step further than that. Thank you for the hard work on the budget. As part of the process for members of the public who came in and got the packet, and it's available online as well, a part of the process that may not be as transparent is when we get the budget, we then ask questions, totaling 100, somewhere around 100?
Yeah, this year it's a little bit less.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, so less. We then
there were some questions offline. That
and yeah, and some of us ask questions like on chart 87 in line 4, can you explain the 7% increase? And on and on and on. And this team, in a very, very, very short order, went through and answered those questions with great specificity, and it's public document. And I appreciate that. I appreciate that you don't just hand us the budget to deliberate. We then have the opportunity to say, I want to understand every single thing in this. So I appreciate the speed of the response to those questions. And I also appreciate my colleagues' detailed questions.
Just yes. as long as we're all chatting. This was my first year, my first budget. And it's not fun, but it's really not. It's a lot of hard work. It's a lot of reading. But I will say that, to your point about all of the questions, if you think that we haven't thought everything through collectively, administration, school committee, read all of the materials that we've been given. It's not easy to make these decisions, but they're necessary. And I'm really hoping that next year's budget process will be much happier.
Thank you. Okay, that's it. All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you.
You do have three yep. other. The town manager has asked that you vote on all three other the facility areas.
Yep.
Separately or all together?
Oh, no, you can do it all together.
Does the town manager care?
Okay. They're separate motions.
Yeah.
Move to approve the FY 2017 Town Core School Building Budget in the amount of $2,273,115.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Move to approve the FY 2017 Town Core Town Building Budget in the amount of $580,675.
Second.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor? 5-0.
Move to approve the FY 2017 Town Facilities Budget in the amount of $286,900.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0. Yes.
I just wanted to say that going to the last financial forum, it was really, I felt really good about the energy in that room and the collaboration that was evident between the town departments. I felt really proud to be a part of Reading and the volunteers in this town trying to make the best out of what we have. So I just wanted to say the energy in that meeting and the intent and the people there really made me proud to be a part of Reading.
And I'll also say I appreciate all the hard work, but the work's not done. We, as I said at the outset, I mean, this budget is more than what the Finance Committee authorized us, so we have to be there and on our game and defend it. But as I said, we've done that before, I feel like they'll support this. So. Thank you.
Thank you.
A motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
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 All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's my favorite one. Congratulations.
I made it through my first one.